we're going to be like vaccinated against every fucking thing. We're going to like treat every damn cancer and get rid of so many diseases and figure out, you know, incredible ways to have robot arms and stuff like that. And it's still going to be a very long time before like things like depression or Parkinson's or just brain stuff, any of that's figured
Why
out.
Why the it's gloomy just, face? Like, You've got robot arms. It's just not making me as happy as I thought they would.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Mind Under Matter podcast. Today, we're going to be talking about, I thought this would be kind of an extension from our last episode about subselves, and maybe we'll even revisit a little bit of that stuff. But Justin, this is kind of another way of thinking interdisciplinary of when thinking about an action. So the last one, we were like, when thinking about some action, you need to think about what subself, what of these seven different subselves might be priming a particular response, whether this has to do with mating or survival. Those are two very different things that might happen. And in this one, we're going to be breaking things down by the effect on a behavior from the context of time, the relationship with the history that caused that behavior. So the idea is, if a behavior happened, you think, what happened in the brain? And this is a lot of Robert Sapolsky's like key stuff that he pounds home, and I'm getting him back on here.
His KFC recipe.
This is his KFC recipe. So what happened seconds before in the brain, what neurons were firing, what part of the brain was activated, and then before you made that movement or whatever. And then before that, what was the environmental cue that triggered that to happen? And then before
that,
which
is seconds and to minutes. Yeah.
Yes. Seconds to minutes. And then hours to days before is what hormones. So what side of the bed did you wake up on? You know, what stage of life development, or you are worked up from work, you get home and your conversation at dinner, or you end up throwing a plate or something. Whatever hormones were going around in your brain influenced the way that environmental stimulus triggered a different reaction in your brain, leading to potentially different behavior. And then you're going back weeks to months before, which is kind of how the brain has what's been going on lately and recency bias. And then going back to adolescence, what kind of, were you popular as a teenager? What were your parents like?
Yes. This is I know we're not done listening it yet, but this is already sounding very Bill Burr to me, the way that he has this joke/rant of like, dude, you know what I realize? Whenever you're talking to someone, you're never just talking to them. You're talking to like what happened to them that morning, spliced with what happened to them last week, their entire childhood, dude. So that's why I just accept everybody. Just, you know, just the way that they are, you know, it's just because you don't know what's going through their head.
Or that's even when they were a baby. Pretty good Phil Burr.
It's just intense. And he's recognizing that, like, this, I'm talking to this person plus what happened to them last week, plus their childhood, plus their brain chemistry. And this would make a cool movie too. Like, the movie starts with what happened a second ago, What happened minutes ago? What happened hours ago? What happened in this kid's childhood? All the way to like, oh, I thought the movie's over, but now we're looking at them like an egg. And we're looking at the cosmos form. Okay, that's our movie. That's the Mom movie premiering at Cannes in 2023.
I mean, it's the movie that we're all experiencing in every movie, in every movement of every day without even being aware that of that story that took place. And then you write it off to something entirely different. Consciousness always dresses up a very smart, intelligent explanation of the lawyers get involved and
a team of lawyers that have revised it and begin it with very flowery language. Yeah, it loves the story.
Actually, speaking of the judicial system, this is something that is near and dear to Sapolsky's heart. So he uses some references. He believes that the criminal justice system just needs to be completely scrapped and restarted from, like, it's just so beyond broken. And which is, he now that he doesn't
have a lab anymore. Can we keep the hammer at least?
Yeah, the gavel.
The judge gavel. Can we just keep that and everything else, like the outfits, the way it's structured, the mandatory minimum sentencing, all that, get rid of it. Private prisons, get rid of it. But the gavel, you can leave that.
Yeah.
As they're carrying out every other piece of furniture.
He spends a lot of time explaining to jury, like now that he's mostly just writing and stopped doing lab work and stuff. And he had he's getting older and wanting to devote more of his time to just communicating science, but he's taken on the project of testifying at a lot of criminal hearings about how different brain damage can lead to impaired regulatory processes and that sort of thing. So anyhow, he uses this one example that you see around a lot because it's such an incredible study. They were trying to figure out why certain people get probation. Why certain people get probation, where it seemed like, you know, these lawyers, you know, you'd work so many cases and you'd be like, my one client had this and got probation. My other client deserved probation more and didn't. And what the heck's going on with this? They studied it. They found out that the further away it's been since the judge has last eaten.
Oh, the lunch thing. You want to get sentenced at 1 and you don't want to get sentenced at like 10:30 because the judge is very hungry and he doesn't know it or she doesn't know it. But it's impacted by that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a very difficult decision to give someone probation and to take on the potential liability if that person goes out and is a reoffender or something like that. So there's just more cognitive thought involved. It takes very little thought to just be like, nah, keep them locked away. And so the more cognitive thought that it takes, the more resources you need, and the more the longer it's been since you've eaten, the less resources you have for those harder, more complex thoughts. But no judge would ever be like, oh yeah, I was hungry, so I locked that person up for 5 more years.
No, I am always impartial. My judgeness is separate from my stomachness, but the stomach is part of the judge. It lives in the judge. And it's got its tendrils tied up against the rest of the decision-making person.
And our ability, as we discussed in the last episode, we also, we see a crime and we have like a disgust reaction, like the same reaction as if you had just eaten a poisonous berry or something. Like that's what that reaction was built for. If you eat a poisonous berry, you're going to want to get ready to throw that up in our evolutionary, as the brain evolved. As more complex parts of the brain got added, it was just like, yeah, we'll just use that part for assessing morality and what is right and wrong. And so that's what a lot of this stuff is about, what all of those various primes. And a lot of it is that it's hard to say that we should do the best that we can, but it's hard to say that we have free will over much of anything when you can't really isolate what about these things actually caused that behavior.
But the problem with that is, which I would love to see Sapolsky's replacement for what the criminal justice system is, and I wish that they took proposals, like he could just lay out a proposal, like, check out my system, works better, huh? And then we could change based on that. But when you say like, okay, this child serial killer, not a child that serial kills, a serial killer that's a grown up that kills children, was only doing it because of their brain chemistry here, their adolescence here. You can trace it all back to physical mechanisms. Therefore, they are a victim because they didn't have any choice. But you can make the argument also that me sentencing them to death, there was no, I couldn't control that either. That was also destined to be based on my reaction to what they did.
Yeah, so that's a really interesting point, and that's a good layer. I mean, to the first part of what do you do about that person, Sapolsky usually says that if a car's brakes don't work, you leave it in the garage. You don't let the thing out on the road. It's not the car's fault that its brakes don't work, you know, but you still don't just have it cruising around on the road. I think.
So is the garage a prison cell or like a home? His idea is like
there are people that are going to need to be segmented off and locked away from society, but we should tease apart that like practical matter of getting a broken machine from damaging a society and running through a crowd or whatever from the moral judgment of like, this person deserves this or has this coming. And those sorts of things are when it like gets messier and wrong, and then biased by other things like skin color, poverty, or various other things that make it really messy, and a sense of justice, you know, and revenge. Like you got to get his take is you got to kind of get that out of it as much as possible. That's just,
is he
like
hopeful?
Mob lynching. No.
Or nah.
I think it's like, why I like
just
him.
The thought of how do you overturn a whole system? It's like pretty optimistic to think you can even make a dent in it, but to say like, let's scrap this and then use the one that is not predatory and that people are profiting off of as we speak. I think as it has to be more profitable to use his system than to keep the current one, because boy, are people making money.
Yeah. And when you say, is he hopeful? I was also just speaking generally. he's not a hopeful sort of human being. He's not a fear monger or anything like that by any means. He's very dry and understated, but he's just like,
Can I bring up the clip? I want to bring up the clip that you sent me of like this. So he's like, our Robert Sapolsky is articulating how, we found not even just the tiniest micron of space to fit in free will between any of the chemical processes in which we divide up every decision you make. We can trace it back to something. There's no space for it. And then the guy listening is like, that is fascinating, and I admire that. But is there... Is there any room for me to have, like, knowing this, to even have a shard of free will? Like, he's like begging him for a shard of free will because he know, because you told me the secret. Do I get to have a little bit? And then Sapolsky says, nah.
After like 3 minutes of pleading, but I know this, and knowing this isn't enough. And then if I do this, and I know that, then maybe then is there some possibility that maybe in some philosophical idea, I have a sliver, a shard of this very long, thoughtful thing. And then he just ends with going, nah.
Yeah. Wouldn't give the man a shard after his beautiful presentation.
Not a shard.
Yeah.
Pass. I mean, it's, you know, people think that you need all of these things to be driven and do good in life. I can't think of a bigger hearted, kinder soul than that guy. He's just a little bit of a nihilist in a lot of ways, or just like, we're just up against the complexity of everything. But
yeah, you can have both. You can be nihilistic and still have joy in your heart. Mm-hmm. But some people just can't stand that. Like, they have to, which I fluctuate, of course, between them. Like, it's, you can't prove that you have free will, but like privately, you just believe it. You're like, I am free will. Everything is an illusion, but my free will, it is all crafted from my wanting it. But then when you're like examining it, it's like, oh, I was holding it upside down. It's the complete opposite of that.
You said a really funny thing when we finished, after we finished recording the sub-self episode, and I was still pondering the notion of you know, when you hear something and you intellectually know something, but then you just like, one day it just gets in your head and you just can't stop pondering it, even though it's something you've known for years, and just like, huh, what's going on with that? Like, just the ad hoc, how kind of slapdash and after the fact life, or the brain was after life. Like, the brain came so much later after life. Our conscious explanations of what we're doing come so much after the fact and are so like irrelevant to why we actually did the thing. And you were talking about how the brain just shows up on the scene. It was like, I did it. I forget exactly how you phrased it, but it was along those lines.
We'll never do again.
But it had me thinking afterwards of just, it is funny that after all of these, so, you know, you go back to the fertilized egg just to get the last of the eight out of there. The decades and millennia before that shaped the culture, and then the millions of years back that evolved that behavior. But it's so funny that you can a baby will come out of the womb and like really quickly just start making assumptions that's like, did I make all this? I must have made up. This is all for me, right? Like, like even crying or what, the baby, if you're a parent or if you're viewing from the outside, babies seem so helpless. But if you're a baby, none of us can remember this well, but if you're a baby, you're still doing things that elicit a response, you know, and learning that you're giggling, that elicits some care, you're crying, that elicits a different kind of care or different, and you're picking up on, like, you know, it's like a video game that you're learning, like, oh, when I press the A button, this person comes over this way. When I press the B button, this person goes away and gets food for me.
Change, because like crying, it works, and then it doesn't. Like, when you get old enough to understand that you shouldn't cry for what you want, like when you're one, they don't go like, don't cry. Like, they don't teach you that. It's like crying means, oh, we got to serve this need to get them to stop crying. But then if you're four, like, you have to teach the kid, like, no, we don't do that. But you learn 2 years before that that's what you should do.
Yeah.
Or something like that. I don't know. I haven't raised a 1 year old. I've been fun uncle, which is a great role. You pop in, you get them a Lego Marvel thing. You never have to discipline. You're the hero.
Yeah, that's that is a good position to be in. Yeah, that it is. Yeah, all of that conditioning happens over time. And I was kind of thinking about that, those stages of development. I had this thought because we are initially maybe going to do just a random like episode where I just say, go through my, I always have just random thoughts in a notebook, just go through, do miscellaneous ones instead of trying to string together a theme and everything. But I had this thought that's relevant the other day about the, how purpose and drive and action, the sort of the things that we've spent so much time talking about on this show, about how they're often like, attempting to, at least consciously, they're attempting to work in unison, or you know, the subconscious and consciousness are attempting to work together, but then they get decoupled in these weird ways too. And one of the funny examples I was thinking about is when you walk into a room to get something and then you get there and you forgot why you're there, which is amazing. Like your intention is in some part of the brain, your intention goes, I should do this thing. And then it motivates another part of the brain to be like, okay, doing that thing, here we go. And then you get there. And then the intention and purpose part of the brain is just like long gone, off thinking about totally other things on the to-do list and everything else. But then the doer guy is like, wait, what? Why? Why did I walk here? What's
and then you happening? Put purpose on a pedestal and you're like, oh, if purpose returns, it will be glorious. And then purpose returns and you're like, oh, I needed a little quarter inch screw to attach the paper towel holder. And then you're just like, oh, I thought it was like a really good purpose, but it was just little with nothing.
That's the worst. That happens in this show where the obsession over a lost idea builds up the idea so much. I'm on a train of thought. I kind of forget where I'm going. And then I'm like, oh, what was that? Oh, it's so important. If I just find that train of thought again, God, it was so good. And then you find it and you're like, oh, no.
Oh, it's the baboon's left ass cheek weighs like a slightly 2% more than the right, which isn't in all baboons, but it's just it's a noticeable thing they found, and they think it's because of how they sleep.
So I was thinking about that in terms of the paths that we get on. We get on a path and then we're just on the path. And it's very easy to forget about the reason for getting on that path in the first place, which is important to remind ourselves, especially because you have more information as you keep on going on the journey. And you do need to think like, well, if I could time travel and tell myself a thing, given the information that I have now, what would I say differently? Like how would I steer that ship differently? Mm-hmm. And we need to be thinking that, because that's not the last turn. That's not the last fork in the road that you're ever going to see in life. So you always need to be gaining more experience and reevaluating past forks for future ones. Cause there's a lot of forks out there.
Have you heard the quote, sometimes your childhood dreams are dreams of a child? So like you might get on a path that your childhood said, like, get on this path. And then you're an adult. You're like, wait a minute, who am I listening to now? Oh, I'm listening to this order given by a 10-year-old and it's not seeing any of this. It's still like just permanently back there forever, frozen in space, like sending you on the journey. And so you always have control. which it's weird because it's like they say don't give up, but then also sometimes you need to adjust course.
Oh yeah. It's like your fucking boss is a 10-year-old version of yourself. It's like some little shit that couldn't imagine what it's like to not like cotton candy anymore. Like that was the sort of goal orienting going on.
Yeah, if they saw pictures of our room, there'd be like, where is it? Did you eat it all? Is it coming to be restocked? I don't understand how you have control over the finances and you're not summoning this stuff using your magic rectangle. I could summon so much cotton candy and like I wouldn't even need my hands. Like I could just use my elbows or something if I lost my hands or my feet I could so easily summon cotton candy here, but I don't do it. I haven't done it once.
Never once summoned cotton candy.
Mm-mm.
So I'm going to restate these again, and then I don't know. Maybe we'll dig into some of them. I can think of a couple examples that we can use for clarification, but just going to riff and see how it goes. So again, 1 second before, what's happening in the brain? Synapses firing, a bunch of neuroscience stuff that we'll probably never teach you on this show because it's just tough. It'd be tough
just for imagine any listener a lightning to just bolt.
Pop in. Yeah.
Imagine a lightning bolt shooting between like a bunch of worms smushed together. The worms smushed together represents the brain, and the lightning bolt represents the neural activity going on in the prefrontal cortex and so on and so forth.
Exactly.
Other than that, you don't need to know anything.
You're just electrocuting worms in your skull through the day.
And then a real scientist would be like, that is actually not a bad metaphor. I would clarify a couple of things, but that isn't a bad way to visualize it, as silly as it may be.
That's because scientists are generally way too understanding and patient. They're just like, yeah, I like the way you're thinking about that.
That's an excellent question. There's a couple of things I would clarify, though, first. Number one, that has nothing to do with the field at all.
There's, oh my God. It's like when I started going to Australia, Tawaii, and doing some No Worries shows and Freshies and Salties. There would be people afterwards, or was it Europe that did this more? I think it was Australia, where they'd be like, oh, brilliant show, mate. And I was like, am I a genius here? I just must be like a genius to them. Like, is it my accent? Brilliant just means like good. It's just like a nice pleasantry.
Yeah.
they were probably saying it because they felt sorry for me. Like, brilliant. Okay. All right. That's a nice job. And I feel like I'm sure it still happens all the time. I know it still happens, but early on in the show, it was just, man, when someone says good question, talking to science, it was always like so intimidating for me. I just did it anyway, but it was way out of my comfort zone. But anytime I get a good question, which is usually just like buy a little time or something to think
exactly.
About
answer, I feel like, and you're not even listening to the answer. Was a good
question?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you pat yourself on the back longer than if you were to catch car keys. You know, when someone throws you car keys and you catch it with one hand, and then your head, you're like, yeah, I caught
Play
the
it
keys.
Cool. Play mm-hmm. it cool. You do this every day. You catch the car keys just like that. You've never
Excellent
missed once.
Question. I've never heard a question that brilliant. If only we could apply your brilliant question mind to answers as well, we would solve most of the Earth's problems. And a lot of part science is actually asking questions. Some people think it's all about answers and beakers, but really it's about being curious and asking the right questions, which you just did. I wanted to say about this this behavior stuff, like,
yeah,
there's realms of it which you can reconcile with, and then, and that's kind of in the middle. Like, if something bad happened to you months ago or in your childhood, you can kind of face that through therapy and doing shadow work and whatnot and psychedelic therapy, whatever, like, angle. But you can't do much about the triggered thing that happens within the second, and you can't do shit about what happened millennia ago.
Exactly.
Are a physical fucking thing of millennia ago shaped into it. You're not gonna, like, become a dolphin because you go to therapy.
Yes, I'm glad that I was thinking that same thing, like, just before this. You really need to think about that in terms of, what am I thinking right now, and is that in my interest, and do I have control over it? Because your evolutionary past doesn't matter. Like, it matters in that being aware of it, to be primed. You are here for this lifetime, and, like, you aren't doing some service to your genes one way, or your genes do not care. You are not living out some legacy because of your ancestors or whatever. I mean, it's nice. You can certainly think of yourself as a part of this magnificent, incredible process, that it's insane that we even get to experience this, and it's the mind-blowing complexity. How do we even get to be here? But your genes don't give a fuck about you. And any idea of giving a fuck about them, like we said, I think we said last time, is, like, it's foolish. Like, you couldn't help your genes if you wanted to, and they don't have your interests in mind. But there are, like, the way in which you've evolved to feel pleasure or to feel pain or to feel confused or whatever other of the emotions that evolved as drivers. Knowing that, I feel like you can hack the system a little bit and be like, I want a little more of that good stuff that evolution equipped me with, and, like, be a little more aware. I actually don't need to pay attention to the, like, wanting to punch people part, or, you know, whatever.
Yeah, I guess on that level, you can change what happens on the second to second reaction basis, because if someone honking a car horn, like, triggers you to get angry all of a sudden, you're like, oh, is that for me? Fuck you. But if you go through it enough, you can kind of dull yourself to it to where that same thing doesn't get triggered. So maybe on that level, you can affect the second to second part.
Absolutely. Training helps. And then also it's just like making your environment simpler because the more complex something is, the lower an openness that you're going to be, the more conservatively that you're going to act and be. There's just going to, because it takes so much energy to consider all these various factors, that without the training and without putting the effort into it and learning about it, it's usually, or just having the experience, usually you're just going to go with the first guess, because there's just, you're just used to making snap judgments and thinking intuitively.
Yeah.
Did that make sense? There's interesting differences between, so we're higher in openness, and then people that are lower in openness have more of an aversion to different things and aspects. If you ask, hey, why is this person poor? If you ask someone higher in openness and someone lower in openness, if you ask them, like, to answer as quickly as possible, about, like, hey, how did this person end up here? Both parties will usually lean toward being like, they're lazy. Some, you know, they did something wrong to deserve this. That's intuitive. People that are higher in openness will over time go from that gut reaction to thinking more cognitively about it and thinking about like, oh, there's all these factors and socioeconomic factors and status things going on and bum luck and blah, blah, blah. Whereas someone that's lower in openness starts with the gut and ends with the gut. Everything is just, it started with that person did something wrong and fucked up, and then thinking of fancier ways of saying that same intuitive thing.
On the show Little Fires Everywhere, the Reese Witherspoon character and the other character, there's a racial dynamic because she's hired her to clean her house and a single black mother and so on. And then she's basically grilling her about bad choices. And then she says, like, you say I made bad choices, but some people had bad choices. And I always like that line. So that's like, sometimes it's like you think it's all about the decisions, but even if you made the right decisions, you had bad decision one and bad choice one and bad choice two. And even if you made the right decision all the way, sometimes, ooh, bad hand.
Yeah.
Bad hand dealt to you. But that's my high and openness, maybe. Maybe everyone is. Maybe everyone poor is bad because they are bad inside and they made the bad choice. But I don't know.
My last serious relationship was with a care coordinator, as I've mentioned on this show before.
What's that?
And you asked that last time too. It's good to, you're an inquisitive person. It's good.
I'm going to remember all of a sudden.
It's basically the program that she had was funded by Washington State. It was looking at the highest users of Medicare and Medicaid and figuring out how can we save money by doing preventative things so these people don't keep showing up in the emergency room because it's costing a fortune. And so just getting things like orthopedic shoes or something, or like a new walker for people or things like that, things so they don't fall as often, you know, stuff like that, making sure that they're taken care of in their assisted living, that sort of thing. She had a guy that was, I wonder, I might have mentioned this last time because it's just, it sticks in my head quite a bit, but she had a guy that was
unlike care coordinator with me.
What's that? Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, I said, unlike care coordinator with me. Yeah. That's like one of those suction cup toothbrush holders that I got from the dollar store where I like put it on and then just drop from the mirror in 2 seconds.
Suction cups. I don't expect you to retain every single word that I've said. I certainly don't. So she had a guy that was like 35 or something like that. And he was out fishing and a huge fucking tree branch just fell out of nowhere.
I was hoping you were going to say fish. Oh, damn. Not paralyzed him, but I was hoping it was a great fishing story.
A huge fish. He was in his boat, fucking huge tree branch falls on the dude. Paralyzed. It did everything right in life, you know, had a good job, everything right.
Nice, not nice to the paralyzed fish's perspective, but yeah.
Fish is like karma.
Yeah.
If the fish saw that happen, the fish would be like, did I do that? Did I make that happen?
No, trust me, Gus, I did it last week. Can't make another branch fall again.
The point is it's awfully hard to lay blame on individuals' shoulders without you know, being aware that you might be falling into the same issue of fundamental attribution errors and just assuming that what you did right, you earned. What they did right, they got lucky. What went wrong for you is bum luck. But I wish I had that one when I believe I've earned every bad thing that's happened to me and then some. I'm so lucky. I can't believe I'm still alive. I can't. How have I not gotten caught for more things? But individual differences apply. But yeah, there's fundamental attribution errors that we all make, because that's a nice protective story to tell yourself. Like, all I have to do is do the right things in life, easy peasy. And I don't, then things won't fall from the sky on me and, you know, life will be grand, because it's horrifying to think otherwise. So
yeah, it's kind of protective. And most of the time you're right. A tree hasn't gotten me once.
It is amazing that we just kind of stumble around through chaos and make it for so long. Like, most people live for 70 years
with cars and everything. Just steel death traps going 90 miles an hour every day with other people you've never met, and the driver's license test is garbage. Anyone can pass it, and if you fail it, you get to take it again next week. Yeah, how is everyone not just piled up on each other?
I think Pete Holmes has some way, joke about it. I think one of his first I think his Comedy Central Presents, his first half hour, he had some joke. Pete Holmes. I don't remember how the joke goes, but it's something to the effect of, how do we still have eyes? How haven't we lost our eyes? They're so fragile.
Yeah, you get one little piece of glass in it or something. Well, so you got the other one. Yeah, I think that too. And it would be so easy to blind someone.
Yeah.
You can, like, a powerful laser from far away. And it shoots straight, and the cops probably won't find it. And why would you want to do that? But just, yeah, how do we not lose our eyes?
Oh, and I mean, and that's part of our evolutionary past, is just building all of these instincts and heuristics that we don't really need to. You don't need to, when you're born, you don't need to calculate, you know, exactly what angle and everything to get food. You just have a nipple pop in your mouth and you just eventually learn to, like, aim toward that thing, and you just have other instincts that take over, and you know how to breathe and everything. And so much of it, we're just on autopilot. But that's also scary with, like you're saying, with cars and everything. It's just, so then we need, that's kind of what laws and policy do, is to build organized heuristics for us. Because if there wasn't lines on the road or streetlights or anything else, there would be a lot more cars smashing into one another. Do you ever see the videos of Russia? I don't know how true this is, but I feel like every video I see of Russia is just cars, like, whipping around on ice on roads. Like, there'll be like 30 of them in a row, just like fishtailing around.
Yeah, and they all look like they're from 20 years ago, and the characters are interesting because they look like English, but none of the letters look like English. It's like if someone who didn't know the alphabet tried to make alphabet letters.
Yeah,
from our perspective, and I know that's not true mostly. I know there's all sorts of similar letters too. Is there? Actually, I haven't spent a second studying Russian.
Yeah, me either. I really got to brush up. Have you heard Bert Kreischer's machine story?
I love it. I've heard it multiple times, and I know he doesn't retire it. I think he closes every show with it, but it's one of the best. He's such a good storyteller, but that's a particularly great story.
It really is. I've read his book where he goes into more depth. No, it was like 5 years ago or something.
And I love that he owns, because I don't know how much of that is embellished, but he says that he often says that his wife is the worst at telling stories ever. Like, she just says the punchline first and stalls and all this crazy stuff. And then he tries to tell her story for her. And then he adds some embellishments in there, and like, he's throwing in like, and it was the first day of school and I'm running around naked and it's crazy and I'm being chased by this guy with a shotgun. And then his wife's like, well, it actually wasn't the first day of school. It was actually the second week of school. He's like, that doesn't matter for the story. You got to say it's the first day of school. I'm terrified. Like, build up, like, whatever it's in the ballpark of, add that. But yeah, the machine story is great. That guy's nuts. He drinks like 40 ounces of Kool-Aid for breakfast and showers in a swimming pool. And he's shirtless all the time. And he's drunk all the time. And he's perfectly healthy, too.
Yeah.
It's a complete anomaly. Yeah.
When he first started doing the taking his shirt off, like on an actual special and stuff, I was like, oof, that is not going to age well. And then... I love Bert Kreischer, by the way. I love him. And then it's doing just fine for him.
Yeah, he built around it regardless. Like, no, I'm pushing this through. I'm going to be the one person that this is okay for. Like the way they say that, don't sit on the stool when you do your act. And then, you know, Mark Maron can do it and Patrice can get away with it. And I don't know who else is a stool person, but there's not a lot. There's not a lot of people who can get away with just sitting on the stool. Chappelle, I guess, but he's not even that much of a, he's half stool, half walk around.
I tried to start using stool a little bit because I get into storytelling sometimes and I try to do a little more. When I started, I was always just talking at the audience. I wasn't like talking with them, sort of. And so I've tried to be a little more casual, but I don't know. Doesn't
something
come
about
natural.
It's not right. Yeah, it's not right unless you got to figure it out, and it's an je ne sais quoi about it. But I don't know. But not everyone is, and maybe you'll get let into the secret parties afterwards too. Like if you truly become a stool guy, they like let you in, and you have a ring that opens secret
parties?
Doors.
Yeah,
yeah. I don't think I could ever be a stool guy. Them. Like. Yeah. I don't know.
Well, you're kind of an absurdist a little bit. I don't feel like a stool works for absurd comedy in the same way. I mean,
no, it doesn't.
I was an absurdist when I started and didn't work. But all right, let's get back into this very important stuff to do. So just to recap, 1 second before we got worm electricities, worms being electrocuted. Seconds before that, what happened in the environment that made your brain electrocute your worms? What hormones did you have circulating in your system that changed the way that you perceived that that potential threat or potential reward? And then how have those experiences been shaped recently? It does say weeks to months before on this, but I think you can just kind of go back through childhood and your upbringing and that human experience. And again, I think that's really interesting, what you brought up about you can change that. You can go to therapy for the childhood trauma. You can work on your human relationships. You can do that stuff much easier than you can trying to like control the way your brain fires in a split second on the road, or change the way your genes have primed you to act in a certain way.
There's certain hardware that is just not alterable, whereas the software is pretty malleable, and then part of the hardware is malleable-ish, but some of that stuff deep in there is just going to be deep in there. But who knows, maybe in 20 years you can turn off genes and turn on genes in a living thing? Like, yeah. I know with some things, but could they
epigenetics?
Are they working on like hair things, like where it's you can turn off the brown hair gene and then make it blue hair and go to a protest or something?
Yeah, I mean, it's what happens. It's what happens over time, depending on environmental triggers. So we would just artificially rig the environment to do that. But yeah, that happens with a good example of how an acute stressor can change the genes that you've evolved with and then set you up for a lifespan thing. The messiness of this is there was this Dutch hunger winter that I may have mentioned before, which is the Nazis cut off the Dutch during some winter and people were starving everywhere. And the mothers that were in their third trimester. So if you're a fetus developing in a mom in a third trimester and your mom's starving, this is what they found, was that kids that were in their third trimester at that time, when they grew up and were in adulthood, they had statistically much higher rates of diabetes.
Oh, and
it's because in that third trimester, there's information coming in from that prenatal environment saying like, there's not a lot of stuff out there to eat. If you have a chance to eat anything, like eat all you can. And not just that, but not just physically eating, but pack away, store the fat in fat cells, be really thrifty with your metabolism. And then because of that, there's only so much fat. The diabetes is caused because it's a one-way communication. There's only so much fat cells that your cells can take on. They have no way of signaling back to, God damn it, what is it? The kidneys? Where's insulin come from? Someone corrected me last time, so now I'm in my head about it.
Man, I didn't even think it was kidneys. I thought it was like some kind of... some insulinary gland structure located not in the stomach, but
where is insulin produced? Pops
in the gut. Right.
You got to guess the pancreas.
Oh, pancreas. I forgot about the pancreas.
Yeah,
I've got one and it's doing stuff and I forgot that it even is a thing. I was like, kidney, yeah. Stomach, liver, intestines, that's everybody on the bus. Let's get out of here. And now I'm like, where's Kevin? And pancreas is the Kevin. And it's like waiting at home like this. But cool, put a pancreas with its hands on its thing. Just kidding. Don't do anything that's not fun. Pancreas. What does it do?
Alone with the pancreas.
In theaters now, Home Alone 5 with Pete Holmes as one of the uncles or something.
I think he is maybe the dad. I haven't seen it.
I thought he was the dad too, but I asked him and he said like, no, I'm just a minor character in it. I'm just in the trailer a lot.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, I know. But I know I haven't checked it out. I would see it just for the Petey pants.
Yeah. So the pancreas, what's sending the insulin, that hormone, to the fat cells. The fat cells aren't taking in the fat, so the fat's still circulating in the blood. So the pancreas is like, fat cells must not have heard us. Then maybe we should scream louder through this hormonal signal until eventually it runs out and it burns, it fries its, it fries its output. And so then you can't naturally, produce insulin. So that's within that prenatal environment, though, those are epigenetic processes that are happening where evolution has shaped your, you with a complex set of genes that have a little wiggle room for switches to be turned on and off depending on various environmental factors, that being a good example of one. And then it's also a good example of the lasting effects of this, because it then takes generations. Because then, so if you're a female that had that type of diabetes, then your body's thrifty, and then when you become pregnant, your fetus is going to be lacking nutrients, some because as a diabetic, you have a thrifty immune system that's kind of withholding. And so there's generations of diabetes from like this one event, from just a rough season. You just happen to be a fetus in the third trimester of your mom's stomach.
Man, and that's such a great, like, it sucks that it's like giving you these instructions, like, okay, you're in the womb now, but when you get out of here, here's some stuff you're going to want to know and behave like, and then you get out into the world and it was the opposite of what you should have been doing.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's these like real basic rules and building blocks that kind of go off and in weird ways. Actually, you know what would be a good one to break a lot of this stuff down with that would be fun for people is incest, because you could talk about why. I'm going to go the incest route, because one, it's attention grabbing. People are like, incest, and it triggers all sorts of moral disgust and things, which gets people's attention.
Unless it's Game of Thrones, and then we're like, yeah.
Yeah. Bring it on.
It's like, it's not enough to just have Jaime Lannister and Cersei. What about if Daenerys and Jon were also related, and then what if you get these people that are related together too? And then all of the porn searches are also that. But then when we're talking about it on here, it's like, ew, no.
So that's adolescence, going back to fetal life, like this example that we just shared. That's going back to fertilized egg, what codes for all of these things. The decades of millennia before, which is like how culture, that's another thing is you arrive in this environment with a culture already in it that you like the
we're
brain
born
is
into culture. Yeah.
And your brain just assumes like, yeah, I guess that's the way things have always been. Seems right to me. McDonald's, Starbucks. Okay. You know, and it just seems that's what your intuition is built on. Whereas if you're somewhere else in the world or a different, any other time in human history, would have been very, very different. And then, so that then factors into what choices did your ancestors make through your evolutionary history that shaped humans, shaped you, how you are today. So yeah, incest is a good one because it has to do with the subselves that we talked about as well, where there's interesting stuff going on. So the reason why incest is bad from a evolutionary perspective is because each individual has something like 4,000 like genetic errors or something like that are, but they're all recessive traits in us.
Yeah. You don't want to double them. If you double them, then you got
flipper babies. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so then there's a mix. So your chance of running into someone with similar, what was the word that I just used?
Similar recessive
traits. The chance of running into and mating with someone with similar recessive traits is pretty low, but then there's all of these hormone interactions that guide that. So there's like major histocompatibility genes. So you smell in a study, females, they have guys wear a shirt as they go and get sweat worked up on a treadmill, and they put these sweaty shirts in bags and then have females smell them for attractiveness. So if you show pictures of a face to someone, females will be like, yeah, that guy's the most attractive, or this guy's the most attractive. It's dependent on whether they're ovulating or not. More alpha when they're ovulating, less more like beta provider-ish traits when they're not ovulating.
I hope this isn't that much of a tangent, but I wonder if this relates at all to when a lot of my woo-woo friends will describe it as like an astrological sense. They're like, I'm in my masculine right now, or I'm in my femme right now. And they describe it throughout the month. And I'm wondering if that ties to like you're in your masculine during your non-ovulation or something like that. Yeah. Because they'll describe exactly that. It's like, sometimes I feel like more in an alpha, but then sometimes that's the opposite of what I want.
Which makes a lot of sense from an evolutionary, from the evolutionary perspective of humans, why females would have more flexible preferences in that way than guys do. Which guys are like pretty darn flexible with preferences.
Yeah. What have you got? but if you did the study with the men, like smelling the shirts, like, hey, where did the shirts go? One of the participants just like ran off with like all of them. Yeah. You need to tell us at least which one you liked best.
Yeah, but what's interesting is if you show females faces of males, so if you show only ovulating women faces of males, they're going to rate them all about the same. So guy A is going to get a 8, guy B is going to get a 4, guy C is going to get a 10, and all these ovulating women are going to rate like roughly around that same thing. What's interesting,
Wait, 8, 10, and 2, you're saying? Like those disparities, or those are just examples?
Yeah, just examples. Like you have a super hot guy, a kind of attractive guy, and then like an ugly guy or whatever. They're going to kind of be in agreement with that as long as they're, if they're all ovulating or they're all not ovulating, either way. But what's really interesting is with this major histocompatibility stuff, with the smell, that throws everything out of whack. So with the shirt smell, every lady is picking a different shirt that smells different, better to her. It's not anywhere near as uniform.
Oh, and they can predict. So that fitness thing is wrong?
Right. And you can predict what shirt a lady is going to pick by just looking at their genomes ahead of time. You would eventually be able to like match this on a dating profile site.
Oh, smell yeah. Something, a smell version of Grindr or Tinder.
Yeah.
That'd be nuts.
Because your olfactory, and females are just more discriminating. So they're just looking for a lot more cues, and they're a lot more fine tuned than males are in a lot of ways. Again, these are all pretty subtle differences at the end of the day. People get up in arms like, you're saying I'm defined by this and that, and men and women aren't. They are subtle differences, but they're still pretty interesting differences. In the end, most men and women like being with someone that is kind and comparably intelligent and that sort of thing. But there are differences in the ways in which we prioritize certain things. And so this major histocompatibility thing is a way that our genes are recognizing different enough genes. So usually what is the attractive property is how different is this potential mate's genome from mine? And that's what's attractive. And so that goes into another, when we were talking about the 7 subselves last week, which, as a reminder, since we're assuming not everyone is watching every episode. We had, you want to try?
That would be
it?
Awesome if everyone watched every episode.
Yeah, I mean, what's wrong with you guys? We're building on big ideas. We're solving the world here. You're missing out. you want to try naming the seven subcells?
Sure. We've got survival coming in first. And boom, following survival, we've got disease avoidance. Looking very fine there. Looking very healthy. Number
these
three
aren't in
coming
any particular
in hot.
Order, but.
Number three coming in hot. Mate acquisition. And coming in on number four, 94.7 The Box, we've got mate retention goes hand in hand with mate acquisition. Now, who we got here coming up number five? Oh, looks like status is coming in number five. Status, number five. Number six, we've got child rearing. And ooh, number seven, the mystery one. Let's see.
You and I are survival. Doing it right now.
Information pass on ability,
affiliative.
There we go. Yeah.
Yes.
See, bonding, I was in it. That's why I couldn't name it. I was standing on it.
That's 6 out of 7. It's a very good grade in this, in the mom university.
Is it an A? No, it's a B. I hated those little quizzes that if you got one wrong, like you get 83. It's like, I just
the reality
one.
Is if you can, you know, they, like I know something pretty well when I've just finished the book. You ask me about it 10 years later, which is a lot of the stuff that we talk about on this show. And it's like, you give me a test in that subject. And if you get like a 50% on something that you learned 10 years ago, that's amazing. That's a failing grade. If you get a high failing grade on something, like you have some pretty good retention.
Yeah.
So we're so used to put the pressure on ourselves to be like, oh, and then I got an A plus or I got a B plus or whatever. And then expect that to just like,
yeah, it's hard.
And keep going in life.
I always like the teachers that had the philosophy of the test is open book because life is open book. You will always have a computer and a calculator and you'll never need to do the arithmetic in your head. However, I'm not going to give you a problem that you've seen before. You're going to have to use the stuff I taught you to apply it in a way that it was not in the exercises. And sometimes I would tank on those, but I still had respect for it. I was like, okay, I was beaten fair and square, not beaten because I didn't remember the symbol that goes with the thing that I could have used on a little paper, but I get it. School stupid.
So back to this major histocompatibility. So there's some inherent differences there where you're actually, there's an aspect of your genes that are subconsciously searching for cues to genetic variety in terms of mating. But when it comes to affiliating and when it comes to survival, your genes are usually averse to differences in genetics.
Because if it was just the first one, then technically wouldn't the most appealing thing be to you like the opposite of the weight spectrum, the ethnicity spectrum? Not that there can be an opposite. Maybe you could say like one very pale Norwegian person that weighs 80 pounds versus someone from Nigeria with Wesley Snipes level darkness and they weighs like 1,000 pounds and is really tall versus the tiniest person. Like, is that technically the most genetic variance or we're talking?
The
physical output, maybe inside they're very similar and that they have the same non-diabetes and non, which brings me to another question. You said recessive traits and aren't, not all recessive traits are bad, right? Like blue eyes are recessive, freckles are recessive, red hair. One could argue blue eyes are bad, like compared to brown eyes, because my eye doctor said that they're better.
Brown eyes are the least
likely to get cataracts or something. The least beautiful, though, I guess blue eyes have the beauty thing or something.
Let's see. Let me pull
this
up.
Ugly blue eyes too.
It's been another.
Doesn't matter.
So having two of the same alleles of a given gene means an individual is homozygous. homozygous? Yes. If the alleles are not identical, then the individual is heterozygous. The sickle cell allele arose as a random mutation in the hemoglobin gene. The individuals who are homozygous for the sickle cell allele have sickle cell disease. Individuals who are homozygous for the normal allele do not have sickle cell disease, but can contract malaria.
What?
So depending on the recessive trait and depending on the dominant trait, going back to that two capital A's, two lowercase A's, or a capital A and a lowercase A, depending on what your environment is, it depends on which of those combinations is going to be the best. So the point that I'm trying to make is that a recessive trait is not necessarily bad. Sometimes it's the best trait that you can have in a given environment, in one that, say, favors blue eyes for whatever reason. In this case, there's some areas where malaria is a bigger threat in the potential of being genetically predisposed to sickle cell anemia is better than because you have immunity against malaria. Does all that make sense?
Oh, completely. Kind of? Yeah. So it's, totally advantageous if malaria is a problem. And if malaria isn't a problem and you're more afraid of getting sickle
now you're just
cell,
getting sickle cell for no which reason.
I don't even know what that is. I've heard sickle cell anemia, but is that like lots of blood loss?
Yeah, I think so.
And it's weird that it's called sickle. Like it sounds like sick and it's the first thing they named. It's like you got sickle cell. Sickle cell anemia.
It does sound awful. It's a cell disease.
Oh, that's not what you want. You want like a broken toenail that grows back in a week. You don't want your cells acting weird.
Yeah. Only rarely do people who have sickle cell trait have complications similar to those seen with sickle cell disease. But the carriers have a defective hemoglobin S gene and they can pass it on to their children and it leads to disorders in the... So instead of a normal red blood cell, there's just this crazy sickle cell. So instead of like a round blood cell, your cell looks like a weird worm.
Oh, and a cinnamon twist instead of a donut.
Yeah.
And so that sucks. You don't want to have going it wrong that small.
Yeah.
Which I mean, any disease is that, but it just sucks that it's like you're falling apart at the smallest level. We don't know what to do about it. We've got some ideas, but it's really tiny.
So then going back to mate choice things, you have a lot of competing interests. You have people that are closer to your in-group socially might be through history might have been more advantageous as people were not overly kind to the difference in outgroups through human history. But having that genetic diversity often leads to healthier offspring. But then there's physical cues too. So your nose is picking up on someone smelling good, but they may not be in great shape or they might be, you know, not in your preferred age range or something like that. So there's a lot of other factors. Insane.
Yeah. The best genetics, but they're just completely insane. Yeah. Cause the tree branch hit their head or something, but genetically like, oh, it's the best smell combination in history. I should go by that, but they are trying to stab me right now.
Yeah. So the reason why it's important to be reductive in science is to isolate these various factors and various like really, really specific primes that do influence very important things like who we spend the rest of our life with. And like, say you're on birth control and you're attracted to someone, then you go off birth control and now they just smell awful. Or there's something about them that you're not attracted to anymore. These are all things that are nice to know before a big commitment. But the worry of reductionism is categorical thinking, which is why, again, you have to go back to these nine factors of thinking of all of this as a whole, and none of these things can be teased apart from this kind of web of causation driving everything. So that's why incest doesn't work out in most species, because there would be advantages to passing more of your genes on otherwise. If instead of 50% of your genes being in your offspring, if you got 75% in there because of a mating with a sibling or parent or something like that, that would theoretically be a lot more of your genes passing on. But the downside of that is so costly that evolution has built our preferences to avoid that in lots of really interesting and subtle ways that don't always have to do with relatedness. So then there's environmental cues that we pick up on. So if you're raised in an orphanage, say with a bunch of kids, this has been like well studied, kids that are all raised together in orphanages, take baths together, everything else. Later on in life, they meet up. They never end up being attracted. Like, none of them end up dating later in life.
They're siblings for all intents and purposes to their core being. They're sibling.
Yeah. So the brain's just going, what am I related to out here? Things that I spend a lot of time with early on in my development. Let's just assume that I'm related to that, essentially, and just it's not even thinking through that much, but let's have a sexual aversion to anything, any individual that I spent a lot of time with.
It's interesting that it's sometimes it has a kind of an opposite thing, which is going by not the avoidance of the incest, but maybe this plays into the cultural, ones, but people that I've heard, like, yeah, I've just always, they're like Indian, and they're like, yeah, I always wanted an Indian wife. Like, I was attracted to white girls in high school, but then when I went to college, then it was like lots of Indian people. And I thought, I would love to be able to pass down my culture. And I've heard it from Chinese people too. And it's not consistent. There's like plenty of people that's the opposite. It's like, no, I want someone different. Or more often than not, it's just, no, that's not even a factor. I don't care I don't even think about whether they were Indian or not. But I always thought that was interesting. People wanting to not date their cousin or brother, but like one step closer to that. It's like, let's keep it in this culture. I thought that was interesting.
It is interesting, and it goes further into what influences our aversions is also based on culture. Because so then you take say rats, for example, and you have them pick a mate based on scent. You just leave the scent of various potential mates, and you see which scent the rat prefers without the potential mates even being there. And they will pick second cousins. So they're not picking distant, they're not picking strangers, they're picking. So you go from, you know, parents sent to sibling sent to cousins to second cousins. They're picking second cousins, usually. I think second cousin, maybe sometimes first cousins, but around
second
that.
Cousin is not your, like, if you your parents' sibling's kid, but one above that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, parents, yeah. Sibling, kid is cousin. Second cousin is, yeah, grandparents, something. Whatever. I'm trying to articulate it. Stupid.
Yeah. So it's another step away. And I think first cousins sometimes as well. And so what's going on there is what you were just mentioning with culture is there's also within in-groups, there's a lot more altruism and reciprocity that happens. And there's a lot more collection of resources or territory that will happen depending on the species. And so if you're if you're, say, mating with a first or second cousin, you're getting a bit more. They have some of your genes, so you're getting a bit more than 50% of your genes into your offspring. The chance of those negative recessive traits pairing up is still relatively low, and you're getting some of the group resource and reciprocal altruism. So there's ideas that through periods of history, this is why different kingdoms would marry off like cousins to one another because of dowries and stuff, because you would keep a lot of that. Otherwise, you're just giving away half of your kingdom or whatever to a bunch of strangers. You're still keeping a lot of those resources and able to accrue more wealth with just having some wonky offspring from time to time, you know, and not enough to. So there's trade-offs there, and there's speculation that's like humans might have been banging their cousins for some time, and that's why we have laws against doing such a thing, because you'd never need to have laws about banging your parents or siblings. Like, no one would ever do that. It doesn't even cross the mind. But people do have hot cousins sometimes. They're like, oh yeah, the cousin that I haven't seen. And the idea is that culture created laws against that, because then the commoners couldn't accrue their resources in the same way as one kind of like out there theory of what's going on with that. So the reason why I like that example is because something like a potential mate is being factored in, their smell, what their hormones are like, what your evolutionary history that caused this, what the culture that you're in says, and what kind of laws and stuff there are about this. And then your childhood, your early adolescent experience are all going into what is you picking a potential mate.
Isn't that going to be wild when as more data becomes available on every individual, and we're giving the data out voluntarily and it's being extracted from us. But imagine like in dating apps, because right now there's a picture of the person, you write a paragraph, there's more pictures, and then you chat on the little thing. But what if it gives you the smell profile also? So it's like, we are an 80% personality match, we are a 70% pheromone smell match, we are a 50% cultural match. And they're like just looking at this grid, and it's like, oh, do I want to go with the person who is more smell match but less of a personality match? Or they're going to be weighing that stuff, and all this talk of the smell and stuff. It's interesting that's the last thing animals start with, that. And then humans, that's the last thing you learn about this person. Like, if you're on the dating apps, you see what they look like, you talk to them, the personality, you hear what they sound like, especially with the masks and COVID stuff of now. It's like the smell is the last thing you notice about a person, probably.
And smell's been atrophying in human
that's why aliens don't have
for a long time.
Yeah, aliens don't have noses, and the mouth is getting smaller. And the eyes are getting bigger for screens. We're so just becoming the stereotypical gray alien. It's hilarious. We're just going to be that. The
brains are getting bigger. Well, one of the restrictions with brain size was very probably. I mean, there's a few things going on, which is, why have bigger brains? It seems intuitive. Listen to how smart we are. Isn't that advantageous? But they're insanely costly. There's something like 20% of our energy is used in our brains.
Giving birth to it, even. Giving birth to it's a big cost.
Yeah. So there's only so big of a head that can fit out of in natural conditions. So that there would have been a lot more death during birth had head size been any larger.
Yeah,
but theoretically, with modern medicine, you can get the big heads out way easier.
If you make the cervix too large, no one will mate with it. And then if you make it too small, I can't pass the baby through it. It's got to have the right in the spot.
And yeah, so who knows what the future will hold. It's interesting just how costly the brain, because there's like, even just for a synapse to fire, there's action potential in a neuron, which is like when it's excitatory and it's about to blast off and start sending signals around that are maybe going to be received by other neurons that have like a limiter. It's basically, you know, like an amount of, we need like 10 signals from 10 different neurons, or one neuron to deliver like 10 signals. And then that lights off this excitatory process. But even during the resting potential, it's a misleading term, because neurons are using like 50% of the energy, something like 50% of the energy that they're using during an action potential. They're using 50% of that energy just to do nothing at all.
What? Why? Just keep it going? Like, yeah, idling costs, like the when your computer is asleep, it's still using a little power.
Yeah, yeah. There's various pumps and stuff that are keeping the charge from negative to positive. And so there's like various inhibitory processes and stuff. So even when it's not working, it's still working. It's just it's such a costly thing. So it's, and a lot of times all this thinking that we do just gets in our fucking way of doing the things that need to get done to keep surviving and reproducing. A lot of times you drink to turn off sections of your brain so you can go to approach the potential mate or whatever.
Yeah. Oh man. When you said it's like zero or one, that's like the value we just give the neuron, right? Like a zero or a one. Cause I remember seeing something about how when we're making neural nets, we give it a value of zero or one per each neural node. But then in our actual brain, it's way more is going on than just it being a zero or a one. There's like crazy complexity within each neuron. But for all like practical purposes, we're like, we're just going to call you firing and not firing.
Yeah. That's really, really, really simplified, but it's a lot more of a charge and hitting a threshold. So there's way more nuance in between, but at the end of the day, it's either firing or not firing. But what's interesting is like when it's close to firing, when it just needs a little bit more, receive a couple more signals and it will fire, compared to when it needs a lot more signals and it's not going to fire, and how long it's going to fire for and everything else. That's all. I'll need to brush up on neuroscience before we get deep into that one day, so to make it an episode people can just fucking skip because it gets
the 100th episode neurospectacular.
It gets pretty fucking tedious and super interesting and everything, because everything's interesting, but man, like, pretty hard for the average person to, pretty hard for me to retain and just blab about without brushing up on. Pretty hard when the first time you're hearing it to not be like, what now? What's happening? I try to stay in the realm of like, people will get this.
Yeah, because that's not a car from the 50s where it's like, well, it's the carburetor and that's the engine and that's the dual cylinder piston and there's a spark of the, it's like there's no this, therefore that easy comparison. It's a lot of wishy-washy, not in that it's not like wishy-washy sounds fake, in too many things intertwined with other things. intertwined with other things that you have to know the names of this and how this behaves to,
It really is. And that's also why you got to be skittish about claims being made about various, you know, neural feedback, various, what this drug will do, whether it's, psychedelic or speed or an antidepressant or, you know, going into a neural feedback doing breath work or what have you, and someone's like, look at this brain and then this region, and here's what the amygdala is doing here, and as you can see here, this C4 zippity zap, and it all sounds really good. And if you don't know any better, anyone can make a case for any fucking thing. And so anytime someone's doing that, you should probably go, are they selling me something? Because if they're trying to sell me a thing, I don't know.
But it showed a gray brain and it became a colorful brain. I want a colorful brain. Yeah. And these pills are the only way I'm going to get one. So hand them over.
And this is to say, like, I clearly like psychedelics. I'm not opposed to other drugs. I actually think that I've been way too hard on pharmaceuticals in some regards, in terms of I've certainly, like, they've helped manage manic issues for me in the past, even though I don't like being on, I'm not on any mood stabilizers and kind of stubbornly refuse to be and don't trust it. And I think that's a healthy attitude, but all that is to say, with even the best of intentions, boy, we have a long way to go to understand neuroscience. We're going to figure out so much. We're going to be like vaccinated against every fucking thing. We're going to like treat every damn cancer and get rid of so many diseases and figure out, you know, incredible ways to have robot arms and stuff like that. And it's still going to be a very long time before like things like depression or Parkinson's or just brain stuff, any of that's figured
Why
out.
Why the gloomy face? Like, you've got robot arms. It's just not making me as happy as I thought they would. Just like picking up trees and planting them on other sides of the lake. That's what I would do with the robot arms.
But anyway, yeah. So all of that, those are some nice little buckets, as Sapolsky likes to say,
buckets
that you have to think about, just like kind of buckets of thought and in terms of like, so he's very worried about people thinking categorically about things, because behaviorists say, oh, you just need to give me anyone with any disposition and I can train them into this. And what was that? That was an Eddie Murphy movie, right?
Which one?
The one where
Dr. Doolittle,
he's like a bum and they give him a bunch of money and teach him how to like be a business person or something like that. For
not coming to America, right? Cause that's the opposite.
Too rich people. No.
Oh, I should see that one. Is it an 80s one? Cause I would love an 80s Eddie Murphy flick right now.
Poor Too Rich movie. Trading Places. You've never seen Trading Places? I remember
like
it quite fondly. But it was 1983, so I bet it didn't age very well.
No, it's perfectly aged because it's so far long ago that its cheesiness is mm-hmm. is a admirable quality now, probably.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you can make the mistake of saying that and like, well, we just need everyone to straighten up and that'll take care of everyone. And that's, and, or you can just condition this and that behavior and everything will work out fine. The behaviorist point of view. And that's not factoring in so many other things. Or you can be like, we just need better genes and we need to get rid of the bad gened people, or we need to, use futurist things to get rid of negative traits and this and that. And that's led to horror shows through history. So the big pitfalls in science were made when, and this is why people rightly criticize like reductive thinking, is because when someone's fallen into this trap of only thinking in this way, like I think therapists for a long time were like, well, it's only childhood stuff, and everyone that has anything wrong, they must have like had bad parents or been diddled or something like that. And that's the only explanation for all of life's problems. So you just get in there and have them re-remember it and work through that, and then everything's fixed. And any thinking, any categorical thinking like that has just time and time again been proven wrong. But it's also important to dive down each one of those categories. You just need to keep tethered to understanding that they all intertwine and influence one another.
No, it's super useful tool. It's just don't throw it out if it doesn't work on everything.
Right.
Put it in the tool bag like we have. We don't have a tool wall, much like Sapolsky's buckets. We have a tool bag. Just a bunch of drill bits and screws and a drill like that presses down into the bottom and some scissors. Get a bag.
So yeah, that's the new thing. And I think that I think we're going to start a new thing on the show. So we'd been doing topic suggestions for a while and doing a public episode from Patreon members recommending those, but I'm always trying to innovate new ideas. I have instead of having a group overshare on my personal Patreon and the Mind Under Matter Patreon, if you're a honey bear, I'm doing a group idea share coming up and seeing how that goes. But one of the things that I'm going to start putting on Patreon is just a Q&A for Ramin and I. Maybe we'll put it on the Mind Under Matter Instagram as well. If you want to follow that, we might throw that in the stories. Because it seems like people like when we get into more personal stuff as well. So rather than always just having to think of some heady concept for us, we'll dive into the mailbag for more personal questions or whatever's on your mind. So be sure to check out patreon.com/mindunderpod, where, by the way, there's some previews to bonus episodes, including the second part of the career assessment episode. And by the way, the Instagram page has a bunch of fun highlights of every episode, including the bonus episodes that we do. So you can always scroll through and just catch a couple bits here and there and see if you are interested in pursuing checking out a particular episode based on that. And I think that's everything that I wanted to mention.
Yeah, so do all those things, repeatedly do them daily, and keep the show growing, and we'll keep on hoeing for you.
Oh, wow, that's a new one.
Yeah.
You keep it growing, we'll keep on hoeing.
Yeah.
Okay.
From your two favorite hoes in the podcast universe.
Oh, all right. I like it. Well, until next time.
Keep on salivating, honeys. Ding.